With the end of the social season in July, the fashionable of London dispersed variously into the countryside, many of them headed for Scotland. Among them were the sisters Stirling and Erskine, who insisted on taking Chopin with them. On August the 6th, he was installed at Calder House near Edinburgh, and despite his mood, he was impressed.
"It is an old manor house surrounded by a vast park with 100-year-old trees. One sees nothing but lawns, trees, mountains, and sky. The walls are 8 feet thick, galleries everywhere, and dark corridors with countless portraits of ancestors of all different colours and with various costumes, some in kilts, some in armour, everything to feed the imagination. The room I occupy has the most splendid view imaginable."
In Scotland, the hospitality and dedication of his dear Scottish ladies, as he called them, reached new heights.
"I no sooner have time to wish for something than it is ready to hand. They even bring me the Paris newspapers every day. I have quiet, peace, and comfort. My room is well away from the others, so that I can play and do as I please. I am completely free. For the chief consideration with these people is that a guest should not be restricted in any way. In my room I found a Broadwood piano, and in the drawing room there is a playl which Miss Stirling brought with her. Country house life here is most pleasant. The houses are elegantly fitted up, libraries, horses, carriages to order, plenty of servants, and so on. Although everyone in high society, especially the ladies, speak French, the general conversation is in English, and then I regret that I can't follow it. But I have neither the time nor the desire to learn the language. Anyhow, I understand everyday conversation. I don't allow myself to be cheated, and I shouldn't starve to death. But that is not enough."
The fact is that Chopin was now largely beyond the reach of those who were most eager to help him.
"It's horrible. I am unwell and depressed, and my hosts simply weary me with their excessive attentions. I can neither breathe nor work. Although I am surrounded by people, I feel alone, alone, alone. All those with whom I was in most intimate harmony have died or left me. All that remains to me is a long nose and a fourth finger out of practice. I can feel neither grief nor joy. My emotions are completely exhausted. I am just vegetating and waiting for it all to end quickly. I haven't a decent musical idea in my head. I am out of my rut, like a donkey at a fancy dress ball, a violin E-string on a double bass, amazed, bewildered, as drowsy as if I were listening to Bodio playing. I am vegetating, patiently waiting for the winter, dreaming now of home, now of Rome. I can scarcely breathe. I am just about ready to give up the ghost."
On a visit to Edinburgh in September, he escaped briefly from his Scottish hosts and visited a Polish family who'd recently settled nearby. The opportunity to speak and hear his own language again filled him with a kind of bittersweet joy, but it was short-lived. As soon as he left his newfound Polish friends, his spirits sank lower than ever.
"Nowadays I am not fit for anything during the whole morning, until 2 o'clock, lunch. And after that, when I have dressed, everything irritates me, and I go on gasping until dinner-time. Dinner over, I have to remain at the table with the menfolk, watching them talk and listening to them drinking. Bored to death, thinking of quite different things from them, in spite of all their politeness and explanatory remarks in French around the table, I must call up all my strength of mind, for they are, by that time, curious to hear me. Afterwards, my good Daniel carries me upstairs to my bedroom, helps me to undress, puts me to bed, leaves a candle. And then I am free to gasp and dream until morning, when it starts all over again. In truth, I feel the world slipping from me. I forget things. I have no strength. Sometimes I seem to recover a little. But then I sink back, lower still.
By now the summer was over. The London rich had returned to the capital, Paris was in a state of semi-chaos, while Chopin remained in Scotland, counting the minutes between periods of sleep, dreading the onset of winter, and unable to make any but the most immediately practical decisions. Beyond the aimless social engagements in his diary, his life had lost any sign of structure or purpose. On the last day of October, Chopin finally returned to London, and for 3 weeks he never left his room. Despite the increasingly critical state of his health, though, he did struggle out once to play at a charity ball for Polish refugees, but he soon wished he hadn't.
As soon as I had finished, I came home, but could not sleep all night. I had an awful headache in addition to my cough and choking spasms. I had already been ill for 2.5 weeks. I really have no heart for anything. Everything is now unbearable for me. Why doesn't God just finish me off straight away, instead of killing me by inches with this fever of indecision?
By the third week in November, Chopin decided to return to Paris before the winter imprisoned him in London. He left England early in the afternoon of the 23rd of November, 1848, though he had to be helped onto the train and into his seat, and reached Paris, as planned, at noon the next day. But it was a Paris much changed. Many aristocratic families, who, like him, had fled the uprisings of the spring, were still unready to return. Among them, of course, were many of his pupils, the principal source of his income. He was too weak to compose, let alone to contemplate performing, so he was more than ever dependent on teaching if he himself was to escape the poverty which he now saw all around him. His prospects had never looked so bleak. Though he put a brave face on it, his situation grew more critical by the day. His teaching soon dwindled to practically nothing, and the will to compose seems to have left him altogether. He now faced living entirely on the charity of his many well-to-do friends, and for a man of his pride this was a bitter pill to swallow. That summer, some influential Polish friends arranged with the Russian authorities for his sister Ludwika and her family to obtain passports for Paris. No one, by this time, was in any doubt as to the urgency of the mission. On the 8th of August, Ludwika, accompanied by her husband and daughter, arrived to nurse her brother through his final decline. Rumours of Chopin's imminent death spread rapidly, and a long sequence of friends prepared to take their leave of him. Among them was the Polish poet Cyprian Norwid.
I found him dressed, but reclining on his bed, with swollen legs. This could be perceived at once, although he wore stockings and shoes. The artist's sister was sitting next to him, strangely resembling him in profile. He was in the shadow of the deep bed with curtains, leaning on his pillows and wrapped in a shawl. And he was very beautiful. And as always, there was something perfect, something classical in his most casual gestures. In a voice broken by his coughing and choking, he began to reproach me for not having come to him for such a long time. After that, he spoke jokingly and wanted to tease me about my mystical tendencies, and since it gave him pleasure, I let him do it. He had fits of coughing, and then the moment came when he had to be alone. I said farewell to him, and he, pressing my hand, threw his hair back from his forehead and said, "I am going," and then began to cough. Upon hearing this, I kissed him on the arm, and knowing that he was pleased when sharply contradicted, I said in a tone that one uses with a strong and courageous person, "You have been going in this way every year, and yet, thank God, we still find you alive."
By the end of September, his condition had rapidly declined. On the evening of the 12th of October, his doctor, fearing that Chopin wouldn't last the night, summoned a priest to administer the final sacraments. But Chopin didn't die as expected. The next day he was often in agony and was slipping in and out of consciousness. For 4 more days he hung on, suffering bouts of extreme pain with a strength and courage both moving and terrible to those who witnessed it. As one friend wrote, "I have never in my life seen such a tenacious vitality."
The whole evening of the 16th was spent reciting litanies. We gave the responses, but Chopin remained silent. Only by his strained breathing could one tell that he was still alive. That evening, 2 doctors examined him. One of them took a candle and, holding it before Chopin's face, which had become quite dark with suffocation, remarked to us that his senses had ceased to function. But when he asked Chopin whether he was still in pain, we quite distinctly heard the answer, "No more." These were the last words heard from his lips.
At around 2 o'clock in the morning of the 17th of October, 1849, Chopin died. He was 39 years old. At his own request, his heart was cut out and sent in an urn to Warsaw, where it rests to this day in the Church of the Holy Cross. When the funeral took place 3 days later, more than 3,000 people crowded into the church, while many hundreds more gathered silently in the streets outside. 1 year later to the day, a Chopin monument carved by Clésanger was unveiled at the burial place, and a handful of Polish earth, brought to Paris expressly for the purpose, was sprinkled on Chopin's grave. It made a fitting end to the public mourning for Poland's greatest composer, but it left unanswered a question which can never be conclusively resolved. Beyond any doubt, Chopin's Polishness played a central role in his life and his music. Of all his works, at least half are deliberately Polish in orientation, Polonaises, Mazurkas, Krakowiaks, and so on, and many of the rest are fairly riddled with Polish characteristics, rhythms, certain turns of melody, certain types of harmony, whose roots lie deep in the Polish folk tradition. Apart from its intrinsic, its purely musical quality, his work takes on an added poignancy if you consider that much of it is the music of an exile. But is it? The fact is that Chopin could long since have gone back to Poland without any danger of political reprisals. He'd never been political in the first place. But he chose not to. He never even visited, nor, as far as we know, did he ever even plan to visit it. The term self-imposed exile is really a contradiction in terms. The fact is that Chopin was a citizen of the world, and his music retains its popularity not because it's Polish, but because it's universal. The most famous of all his specifically Polish works, the great A-flat major Polonaise, is not about Polish nationalism, but about nationalism itself, more to the point, about community in its widest sense, about identity. It's not about Polish heroism, it's about heroism. Chopin's music is all but universally popular because it resonates with experience that's universally understood. It's not just about him, it's about us. When all is said and done, it's about life and the courage of living it.